right. Good morning. I don't know if it's the turkey or the stuffing or what, but I'm feeling kind of tired today. So maybe it's just the holidays. We'll see. I'll get pepped up here. But we're going to go ahead and get started with our weekly prophetic super sign. My favorite time of the week. We look at things that are leading up to the return of Jesus. Everyone kind of sees the, you know, the stuff that's going on in Ferguson. We see riots. It's not just the riots. It's just, do you guys not sense that there is a growing level of just division among different groups of people, whether it's people disillusioned with government, whether it's people disillusioned with multiple different things? You can kind of just see things beginning to get to levels where the entire world is going to start looking for somebody to start sorting out all these problems. You know what I mean? That's what we're kind of watching on our radar. On the East Coast, we saw some crazy winter storms. I don't know if you guys saw that. Look at that picture on the right. Could you imagine that's your downstairs? Just so much snow that it just pushes the door in. They're getting like record-breaking snow on the East Coast. So of course we can expect wacky weather before Jesus comes back, right? Another sign, I don't know if there's any Star Wars nerds out there, but they announced this week that that Star Wars is coming back. And do you guys know what number this is?
Seven.
Number seven. So once again, there's our number of completion. We know Jesus is coming back, right? But my weekly prophetic super sign for this week is the fact that IQ levels continue to plummet. So we're getting dumber. I don't know why the cats are in this video, but can't go wrong with cats. Yeah. Okay, that one you might need to see a couple times. Let me play that one for you again. Watch the trainer. I think that I'm partial to this one because I worked in the gym for 4 years, and you see some pretty crazy stuff. But you guys gotta understand, this guy's legs are—they're clamped in here. Like he's not getting his legs out, and it's at about this point right here that he realizes he's in trouble, and he tries to roll out of it. Okay. So we definitely know that is a super sign of the return of Christ as we see IQ levels continue to plummet. We'll go ahead and pray and get serious and get started here.
God is good, isn't he?
Amen.
Father God in heaven, thank you for this time that we can gather together to study your word without fear of persecution. We just hope that the technology can run smoothly today, that you know this lesson can really affect our lives, that we can share it with others. And we thank you so much for revealing a lot of this to Chuck. And we do this for your honor and for your glory. It's in the name of your son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. You guys will notice this tall, young, strapping lad next to me. Tyler is off this week in Texas with family. So he's having a good time down there. I'm sure he's getting people saved. He's pretty bold.
He's our evangelist.
He is definitely an evangelist. If you guys ever need him to talk somebody about Jesus, he'll gladly do it.
He's fearless.
He is fearless. All right, so we're getting into the menorah today. We're going to finish it up. there's a picture of what the menorah would have looked like in the tabernacle. Just for really quick review, we've already covered the entire... Remember, we're going to look at three types and shadows of this menorah. The first type was the fact that Jesus symbolizes the menorah itself, just Jesus. The second one we looked at was you and I, as an individual believer in Jesus, are in that menorah. That was where we're at today, or where we finished last week. And that's some of the bullet points here. So we are one flesh in Jesus. We looked at that verse where basically Eve was taken out of Adam's side and she was one flesh with Adam. We kind of see that picture of Jesus and us in the church. It says that we are one in Christ, and we can kind of see that in the menorah. Jesus is the vine, we are the branches. Remember that that middle shaft represents Jesus, and we are those outside branches all branching off of him. Also, remember that there were nine manifestations of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5, and we reflect those in those weird little bowls and knobs and flowers that are all decorated throughout that menorah. And the thing we finished with last week was that the Holy Spirit, remember how we saw the Holy Spirit rest on Jesus when he was being baptized? We see the Father speak, the Holy Spirit rest on Jesus, so we have the whole Trinity present there. That same way that the Holy Spirit rests on Jesus, he rests on us as individual believers. And that's once again a picture of the menorah, in that remember that this menorah, those seven lamps on top, actually that you could take those off. You could take the lamps off of the menorah and place them on. So that shows a picture of those lamps representing the Holy Spirit coming to rest upon us. So just that was our review right there in John 1. At that baptism, when the Holy Spirit descended, we see that he remained upon him. The Greek word is meno. And as I've already stated here in John 14, when we're promised that Holy Spirit, it says that he will abide with us forever and that he dwells with us and he will be in us. That same Greek word that was used for Jesus is used for us. So we have that connection right there. Okay, so we're still along the lines of studying the manifestation of that sevenfold spirit. You guys remember how we've kind of studied Isaiah chapter 11, and it talks about those seven attributes of the Holy Spirit. When we looked at that first type of the menorah, we saw that Jesus is the one who perfectly fulfills all those different attributes. Perfect knowledge, perfect fear, perfect wisdom, perfect understanding, etc. So what I want you guys to see is that this menorah could also be viewed as our, as individual believers, progression of sanctification. So our daily walk towards a more Christ-likeness. I've actually had Derrik studying a lot for me these key words as far as this, the sevenfold spirit. So I'm going to have him say a couple sentences here on this progress of sanctification and how we can see it progressing in our daily walks.
Yeah, and I find it really fascinating too, because in several models, like in the Bible and also in real world application, you see that it's almost like it's pointing inwards and it's always towards God. And as far as this sevenfold spirit manifestation, I think it does the same model, but you'll see that you start off with knowledge and fear of the Lord. That's what the fear there means. As we went over a little bit last week, the knowledge is like facts, just information, you know, that's what the scholars do. And then you also got the fear of the Lord. We read in Proverbs that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of all knowledge. So that's how those are connected. And there's actually two different opinions on like what does fear of the Lord mean. And I actually agree with both of them. One of them is like the more comfortable, like F-E-A-R, fear equals awe and reverence. So it's like, you know, you're just completely in awe of God's glory and power. But also, if you read the scriptures, you can see that people are, there's times that they're literally trembling, like afraid of God too. And you know, I love my dad to death, and I can tell you I had a very healthy fear of him growing up. Like, he kept me in line, and if I screwed up, I was definitely afraid of him that way. So we see that God kind of manifests in that way too. And of course, if you have that fear of the Lord, both in reverence and in, you know, actual fear, it leads to submission to the Father's will, which is where we get the next one, which is counsel and might. So because you want to submit to God's will because of your fear of him, you're also going to him for counsel. What do I do with the knowledge that I have gained through you, right? And then that's where you get might too. It's, you know, you now know what to do, and now you have the ability to do it. And after you put this knowledge in practice, you know, through experience, that leads to wisdom and understanding. And if you look up the word wisdom and see like how many times it's used in the Bible, you'll see like, I think over half the time it's also coupled with the word understanding. So we have knowledge, then we have fear of the Lord, then it goes to counsel might. So we're putting into action the knowledge we have, and that leads to understanding. So now that you see like how all the knowledge connects, and so you gain understanding from that and through wisdom. I lost my train of thought.
Then you apply it.
Yeah. I was looking for that word apply. Mm-hmm. So, and then also it's kind of subtle in here, but you can see that you start out here, and as you go in, it's also humility. I heard a proverb one time that knowledge is arrogant about how much it knows, but wisdom is humbled by how little it knows. And of course, I can say in my own walk, 5-6 years ago, I was very arrogant in the knowledge I did have, but it, you know, the biggest thing I've learned over the years is how little I actually know. And so you see this all coming together, that it all points to the Spirit of the Lord, which is Yahweh.
Yep, perfect. So you guys kind of see that inward progression. What I also want you guys to get is that we will progress in these at different levels at different times. Obviously, as we grow, sometimes we may grow more in a greater understanding. Mm-hmm. So it's not necessarily a specific pattern, one size fits all. We're growing in all these areas each and every day of our walks. Hopefully, I mean, in submission to God, that's where you want to grow, is in all these areas. So we just wanted you guys to kind of get a general understanding of that. As stated, Derrik summarizing everything, we could spend an entire teaching series on just each one of those words.
Honestly, so. as a side study, I find this Isaiah 11:2 incredibly fascinating. I put hours of study into it, and I don't even feel like I've scratched the surface.
Yep. So. Okay. So that was kind of a summary of those. Now we're continuing on with our illustration of the menorah. So remember that the high priests all pointed those lamps facing straight forward, remember? Remember that they're pointing straight forward towards the table of showbread. So what does this signify? So remember that in Jesus we now have fellowship with the Father. So we got to go back to this tabernacle scene. Remember how where the menorah is right there highlighted. The menorah is in front of that highlighted object. But we see in this tabernacle kind of a representation of everything in our spiritual lives. So that menorah lights up the presence of the Father. Remember that there's that purple veil right there where we would consider the Shekinah glory of God on that far left. And we're separated from that. But remember that Jesus, when he died, he tore that veil, right? Mm-hmm. So now we have access to the Father. So that menorah lights up that presence to the Father. Jesus in we in Jesus, now we have presence and access to that Father through the torn veil. Also, we see that the menorah lights up that table of incense there. The incense represents, is symbolic of prayer. We know that when we pray to the Father through Jesus, our prayers are answered, right? So once again, that's another type of the menorah. And finally, check out that the special emphasis is on the table of showbread. Like we've said before, that table of showbread represents fellowship, right? We know that the Father wants intimacy with his creation. He wants intimacy with us. So once again, through Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, we now have that direct fellowship with the Father. Okay? And we'll look at that real quick right here. So Jesus is our daily bread. So that table of presence, that bread that's sitting there on the table that the menorah lights up, is pointing to that bread, that fellowship. That daily bread is Jesus. Jesus says, I am the bread of life, right? And we also have reconciliation. We know that table of reconciliation is Jesus' broken body. So that lamp illustrates that. So, as we've stated before, the lamps facing forward could have possible secondary illusions. It could just be that when we're in Christ, we're walking the straight path, right? We're not to swear from the right to the left. We're supposed to stay right on task. And only through Jesus can we walk that straight path. And also that pointing forward could be alluding to the fact that we are to look north, and north is terms of, in Scripture, that there seems to be a hint that looking north is like looking towards heaven, keeping ourselves heavenly-minded, focusing on our Father and our Father's house, okay? Remember that all the accessories are pure gold. So once again, even everything that's touching this menorah has to be a pure gold. That this is symbolic of the fact that only deity can touch the wicks of this menorah. There can be no human contact with this menorah. And that is symbolic of the fact that man is fallen. We're sinful. We have nothing to do with our spiritual walks. besides submission to the Lord? And we'll kind of look at that here. Remember that cool part of the first type where we learned that the Israelites bring olive oil? In Leviticus 24, it says, "Command the children of Israel that they bring to you pure oil of pressed olives for the light to make the lamp to burn continually." And we saw in Jesus that we know that the Garden of Gethsemane, and we talked about how Jesus didn't have to die on a cross, right? I see this bringing pure oil, or bringing the pure oil from the pressed olives as our free will, okay? We don't have to walk in sanctification. We don't have to follow Jesus every day. We don't have to name the list goes on and on, but we do. So what is our pressing of the oil? I believe that our pressing of the oil is sanctification. Long story short, so Jesus's Gethsemane experience. Our Gethsemane experience, we see Jesus over and over again tell us to die to ourselves, right? Put to death what we want to do and follow what he wants to do, right? Jesus over and over again tells us to carry our cross. One of the greatest illustrations I ever got of understanding carrying the cross, when convicts would carry their cross through the town, literally people would yell at those convicts saying, "Dead men walking." They were dead. They were already good as dead. They were walking to their crucifixion place, right? That's how we're seen in Christ. We are already dead. We are already in Christ. We've already... totally lost my train of thought. But we are already there. Like, we are already dead in Christ. And that carrying our cross is our submitting, not our way, but his way, right? So that's our key word of submission. That's how we crush those olives. And the olive tree is symbolic of Israel's religious privileges. So what that just basically means is we represent the religion of our Father. If you really want to know the Father's heart, you study the Old Testament, right? We learn how he worked with his people, the Israelites. They were supposed to represent what quote-unquote religion would look like to an outside world, okay? And we can pick up some common general things if we know what true religion is. The book of James says, true religion is this: take care of the orphans, the widows, do not be spotted by the world, right? So now our acts of quote-unquote religion, which I don't really like that word, but there are religious acts that we do that represent the Father to a lost world. And that's kind of a picture of us pressing the oil. Remember that the menorah was to burn from evening until morning. There's this special emphasis on the fact that it's burning at night. Remember, we know that the menorah is burning the whole day. So why is there this special emphasis on it burning at night in its darkest hours? I believe that this is symbolic of the fact that we are the only light in this dark and fallen world. We, in Christ, as symbolic of that menorah, are the only light in this fallen world. We reveal the light of God through the sevenfold manifestation of the Holy Spirit. As Derrik was talking about, all those progressions of sanctifications, the more we learn to walk like Christ through submission to him and the Holy Spirit, the more we will reflect that light to others. Does that make sense? And they will see that illumination through the Holy Spirit. And that's our goal. And it's important to remember that, I don't know if you guys have ever been a super dark place, but the darker the world gets, the darker the atmosphere gets, the brighter that one light is. I don't know if you guys notice this, but our world is getting extremely dark. And instead of Christians kind of backing down, this is our opportunity to shine even brighter, right? So that's kind of symbolic of that. And we see Jesus right here in Matthew 5 say, "You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand." That's our exact Greek word for what we're studying here, menorah. He's literally giving us an illustration that we are part of that menorah. "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven." So once again, there's kind of a picture of that works. We bring our works, and those works display to the world the love of the Father. So the high priest tends to the menorah. Once again, so there were lots and lots of priests in the Israeli camp, but only the high priest was to take care of this menorah in the tabernacle. So we know that that is illustrative of the fact that the high priest is in charge of the lamp. So as I stated before, some of the things he does is he fills the oil, he trims the wicks, he lifts the wicks, he removes the ash. Jesus is our high priest, and the Father could also be symbolic of our high priest because they tend to us in our spiritual walks. We see that. So remember that we bring the pressed oil. We don't do the oil ourselves. The oil is symbolic of the Holy Spirit. Our works bring that oil, right? So he takes that oil, the high priest does, and puts it in the menorah. So once again, it's not anything that we do, it's what he does through us, right? That's an illustration of that. Trimming our wicks. I don't know about you guys, but how many times has God had to trim things out of your life? How many times has he taken away things that you thought were important that you later learned weren't? Lifting your wicks. So what the priest would do is he would literally lift the wick up to make your lights brighter. How many times has Jesus had to comfort you, build you up? How many times has he exhorted you to be a greater light to the world? And we also see, remember those, so at the trays and the cutting utensils for the candle, what they would do is they would take these leftover ash, all this dead stuff, and they would lay it on these golden trays, and they would take it out to be discarded. Once again, that's just symbolic of a daily cleansing. These menorahs need to be daily cleansed and removed of dead things, dead works. Did you have anything to add about that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, so I want to look really quick about this daily cleansing. How many of you guys remember the story of Jesus watching the disciples' feet?
Yeah.
Right? We've heard this story a million times. One of the contexts that people generally like to show is they like to say, well, look, this is a good story about Jesus being submissive, right? He's being a servant to his disciples, and we're supposed to follow that example. I totally believe that's true, and I totally believe that is a primary application. But I think a lot of times when people look at this foot washing, they miss a big application of what's really there. So let's check this verse out real quick. So Jesus is getting ready to wash Peter's feet, and he says, Peter said to him, "You shall never wash my feet." Jesus answered him and said, "If I do not wash you, you have no part with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head," right? Peter's like, okay, now bathe me. And Jesus said to him, "He who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean. And you are clean, but not all of you." What I want you guys to get is what the main point that Jesus is trying to get through here is that this is an issue of cleansing and forgiveness of sins. Okay, so when Jesus says he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, so when we trust Jesus, we are completely washed clean. When you trust Jesus, you're completely washed clean. But guess what? Daily in our walks, we're unfortunately walking in a fallen world, right? And I don't know about you guys, but I mess up a lot, right? We're messing up constantly. So when we're walking in the sin-fallen world and when we're messing up, what has to happen? We have to have our feet cleansed, right? So that Jesus cleansing of the disciples' feet, what he's saying there is you guys only need to have your feet washed. You guys have already been totally cleansed, but now I need to daily wash your feet. I'm not trying to sound like a super Christian, but one of the things I do when I'm praying for my forgiveness is I pray, Lord Jesus, wash my feet. That daily dirt that we get on our feet from just walking. But as I stated, I think that this little foot washing episode is symbolic of that high priest kind of taking those dead works of the ashes and taking them outside and throwing them away, discarding it, cleaning us from our dead works. Does that make sense? You guys making a little connection there? So if you want to get into your big theological terms, so when Jesus says he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, you can look at that in terms of justification. So when you're saved, you're justified. But that daily foot washing or that daily cleansing would be our sanctification. So the washing of the feet is symbolic of sanctification. Okay, now all of that was just background for what we're getting into here. This is the whole point of what I wanted to get into, the reason why I even went off on the tangent of the menorah. So those first two types, that was just bonus material for you guys. I hope you enjoyed it. But now we're going to actually get into the third type. So what is this menorah symbolic of, and why is it important to our study? And I hope that all that background information now will transition more into what we're studying in Revelation 2 and 3. And I think with all that background information, it actually will quite significantly. So this type or shadow 3 is that physical menorah that we see represents the corporate church in Christ. That represents us, ES first, in Christ. Okay, and we're going to look at that. This one's pretty easy, and as I said, it states into our chapter in Revelation. So we go back to Revelation 1, verse 20. The seven lampstands which you saw are the seven churches. Okay, it's pretty straightforward. We know that those seven churches individually have a menorah. Okay, And once again, whatever that looked like, whatever vision John saw, I'm not 100% sure, but I know that when he saw seven candlesticks, and each church had its own candlestick. Now, to be honest with you, I've wrecked my brain over this. And I think the reason that I wrecked my brain over this is because I'm trying to understand a multidimensional reality, and I can't, okay? So when I say that each church has a menorah, each one of those seven churches has a menorah, I think it's safe to say our church here at ES First has a menorah, right? Now, what does that look like? I don't know. Is it like an individual? Like, does ES First have a menorah and this church have a menorah? Or is it like Excelsior Springs has a menorah, or Missouri has a menorah, or the United... Do you guys see what I'm saying? When we see Ephesus and Smyrna, those were kind of... What would those be considered? Countries? Provinces? I don't know. But it was kind of... There were multiple gatherings that were represented that menorah. So I don't necessarily know, but I probably believe that it's multifaceted. As I said, it's hyperdimensional. We don't really get to know. So I personally believe that ES First has its own menorah. I do, and I believe that we are a light of the world. So what does that mean to us? So let's go back all the way to remember that menorah was of beaten gold. It was one piece, and it was beaten. Though many, we are one. All of us in this room are one in Christ, right? And remember that central shaft is symbolic of kind of our leader. I believe that there could be a hint that our lead pastor, so Pastor Block, would represent that middle shaft. And there could possibly even be a correlation to the angel of the church, of each church, or the lead messenger. I believe that Pastor Block is the lead messenger of this church, right? And we're all kind of symbolically in him as our church head representative. How many of you guys know that it's not easy being unified in a church? We're all a bunch of different people, right? And I see that as symbolic of that beaten aspect of the gold. But what's important to remember is we're still seen as pure. With all of our defilements, with all of our mess-ups, we're still seen as pure gold in Christ. So that's kind of cool. So... here's some kind of fun things, looking at the bowls, knobs, and flowers that I discovered. I may be stretching here, I may not. You guys decide, it's fun. So we see, remember that each one of those little subgroups has a bowl, a knob, and a flower, right? So each little thing has three items, and we see each branch, if you add up the things, has nine objects, right? In 1 Corinthians 12, it talks about the diversities of gifts. Does anybody want to guess how many gifts of the Spirit there are, manifestations? Nine. We have the word of wisdom, knowledge, faith, healings, miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, tongues, and nine, interpretation of tongues. So, pretty cool little connection there. Once again, we have nine objects. Check this verse out here. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 28 and 29. And God has appointed these first, apostles, two, prophets, third, teachers, four, miracles, miracles, then gifts, five, healing, six, helps, seven. I'm sorry, I got that messed up. Did I?
Well, first, gifts of healing.
Yeah, gifts of healing, I'm sorry. Helps, administrations, and varieties of tongues. There's only eight listed there, but if you look at the varieties of tongues and there's an interpreter inferred, you could look at nine items there. That may be a stretch. I don't know, I just had fun with it. But I think those connections, you know, are kind of cool. And once again, don't think that those are complete lists. Like, I don't think that those necessarily represent all that the Holy Spirit is doing, but I do look at them as a perfect manifestation of the Trinity through man. Three is the number of the Holy Spirit. Three is the number of Trinity. Three, three, three. Very symbolic of just the Holy Spirit working through man. So, another thing keep in mind that these seven lamps, that the greatest manifestation of light is corporate. So think about that for a second. Those of us that are not exercising our gifts are dimming the light, right? So if we are symbolic of a menorah, you can kind of see that those members of the church who aren't exercising their spiritual gift, and by the way, each and every one of us is given a spiritual gift. It's clear in Scripture that each and every one of us has a special gift. And if we aren't exercising our spiritual gift, we're actually dimming the menorah of ES First, and we're not giving off that corporate light. So that's super important for us to remember. So remember that the lamps face forward. So what is this symbolic of? This church, ES First, lights up the holy place. So it what we do is we light up that presence. We show the world how to get access to the Father, right? Remember, that special emphasis is on the table of showbread. That special emphasis is pointing towards the bread. We as a church body, we want to bring people in and we want to show them the Lord's table, right? We want to get them to partake of the bread and the wine of Christ. That's what we're corporately doing. I think this verse summarizes the lamps facing forward towards the table of presence. 2 Corinthians 5:18 through 20. Now all these things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Once again, we've seen all through the scriptures that God wants fellowship with his man, right? He wants fellowship. And that table of presence represents that fellowship. We as a corporate body point people in that direction. You guys seeing that connection with the menorah? Pretty cool stuff. So remember that there's that special emphasis on it burning from evening until morning on darkness. So the church equals salt and light, right? We hear it over and over and over again. What's amazing is salt is seen as a preserving agent, but it's also an anti, I can't think of any other word other than retardation. Like it keeps things from going bad, right? That's what we are. That's what we are in this world. So, you know, a lot of people say that there's problems in America, right? There's this wrong and this wrong. We have a tendency to all just want to complain. But the question that I have is for us internally is, what are we doing? You know, if we know that there's problems going on, we know the reality of those problems aren't man-made, right? But yet a majority of Christians, and I know it's not a lot of us in this room because we're a spirit-filled church that focuses on the spirit, but a majority of Christians that I come in contact with don't even understand there's a spiritual reality to anything. They don't even understand that there's a spiritual war being fought. They don't even understand that reality. So how could they even fight with the weapons that we're supposed to fight with prayer, etc.? So one of the reasons we see the world, or especially the United States, growing darker and darker and darker, I personally feel, is that the American church has lost that aspect of spiritual reality. They've lost that need to pray. They've lost that getting on their face towards God. And also what's being preached out of a lot of pulpits. I mean, we don't have to name names or look at anything, but if we're not being the light of the world, we're not being the salt and the light. So instead of complaining, I think that we should just start praying, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's our job. Do all these things without complaining and disputing, that you may become blameless and harmless, children of God without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as lights in the world. That's us, corporately, shining as lights in the world. So the high priest tends to the menorah. So, long story short, I'm going to finish up with this. This is kind of culminating and bringing us into perfect timing, because, like I said, all that was kind of background information. What I really wanted you guys to see was this vision that we have in John, where John sees this risen Christ, and we see him with the golden sash and the long robe, is a picture of Jesus being our high priest. So now my goal for you guys to be able to see more of what he was doing, right? And once again, we started the entire lesson with this verse from Hebrews. Now this is the main point of the things we are saying. We have such a high priest who is seated at the right hand of the throne of majesty in the heavens, a minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord erected and not man. So we see Jesus as high priest right now, ministering. Okay. So my goal is for you guys to be able to get a greater understanding now of what exactly that looks like, what he's doing. And by the way, Jesus is alluded to as high priest at least 14 times in the book of Hebrews, at least. So with all that being said, you see that visual on the left. Remember, that's our original vision from John, right? And we see Jesus in the midst of these seven lampstands. So what is he doing? What exactly is going on? I believe that what he's doing is he is in the heavenly tabernacle acting as the high priest during the church age. Do you guys kind of get that connection? Do you see why I did all that background information leading up to where we're at today? I know it's a lot, but I think that there's a lot of really cool stuff out of that. And it'll make more sense as we're plugging in chapters 2 and 3. So what is Jesus doing? He's filling our oil. We're going to see in Revelation 2 and 3, seven times Jesus says to each one of those churches, I know your works. I know what you're doing. He's taken those works and he's doing different things with them. Trimming wicks, I can see that as kind of a condemnation sometimes. He's trimming away some of the bad stuff, right? You're going to see over and over again in these churches, he's trimming away bad stuff. Commendation, he's lifting wicks. We'll see in Revelation 2 and 3, he has something good to say about most of the churches. Not all, but most. And he exhorts them. He tells them what to do. So if something's good, then what to do. Then the removing of the ash. We see him removing dead works and cleansing. He gives actually five out of the seven churches we're going to study are told to repent, to change their mind, to do something different. And if they do, he'll cleanse them from that. And also there's a warning in the first church that if they don't change, he will remove them from their position if the church fails. That's extremely scary to think about. There is a corporate body that he could remove, that menorah, and I believe that's representative of us, removing his influence. He could take away where you're no longer a light to the world, and that's extremely scary. So, see what time I got? 9:48. I'm going to leave you guys with this. This is going to be kind of a little cliffhanger to get you guys excited to come back, because this grand finale that we're getting ready to get into is like the funnest of the fun. It's the coolest of the cool. But do you guys feel that was beneficial, going through all that background information with the high priest and menorah, just to get to where we're at? I think it's kind of cool. So what's really in view here in our chapter in Revelation chapter 1? Okay, I see that Jesus is tending those local seven churches of the book of Revelation. Okay. There were seven literal churches that existed at that time, right? And Jesus is literally ministering to those seven churches. He's acting as high priest at that time. You guys get that? Tracking with me? But there's more in view there. We also see Jesus tending to the complete church at that time. Remember, this is a picture of seven churches, but we know there was at least 100 at that time, if not more, which is, we know that those seven were representative of the whole, right? So not only do we see Jesus acting for those seven, but we know symbolically and multidimensionally he's working on all the churches all the time. Does that make sense? I know it's getting kind of crazy here. This last one's even crazier. Jesus, we have in view, tending the complete church for the entire church age. Now, before I even get into this next week, I want you guys to know that this is not without controversy. There are some theologians who disagree with some of the things that I'm about to say. But what I believe is those seven churches symbolically, chronologically lay out what the entire 2,000-year church age. Okay, and I know that sounds kind of intriguing, mysterious, but I'm going to have to teach you all that next week. But that's kind of where we're going with this. Don't look at that. That was top secret. So,
Little tease.
So like I said, remember how we've been asking you guys over and over and over again, why did Jesus pick those seven churches? Why did he pick those seven churches? That was the big mystery. And you can rack your brain with it. Why did Jesus pick those seven out of the 100 or so that existed at that time? Each one of those pictures, or each one of those churches, like I said, lays out a period of the 2,000-year church age in perfect chronological order. And what's cool is as we study Revelation 2 and 3, is you guys will get to see if this is a stretch. You guys will get to decide if that picture is actually there. And I think that you guys will see that it's pretty blatant that it is. So, and that's kind of where we're going next week. And what's perfect is this is a perfect transition. We'll be closing with the menorah. We're done with the menorah, but we're going to transition into 2 and 3 with the churches next week. So let's pray, and we'll get out of here. God, we thank you so much once again for another lesson. God, I know that sometimes we're getting into things that are in a multidimensional level, and it's extremely hard for us to grasp, but somehow you give us pictures, you give us symbols, you give us a menorah, you give us different ways to really bring these truths home and help us to get a clearer picture of how you work and who you are. God, we pray that you continue to minister as high priest to the menorah of ES First. We pray that you help us to make our lights shine greater, God, and we pray that you would embolden us to take this message of reconciliation to the world, and that we would demonstrate who you are, Father, to a lost and fallen world. God, we pray that you prepare our hearts today for your message and to hear from you. Speak to Pastor today. We just love you. We can't thank you enough. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If you've enjoyed our presentations or felt led by the Lord, please feel free to donate at esfirst.org.